Let me welcome everyone. Let me underscore welcome. We are very pleased to have you here to the annual Wallace Stegner Lecture, the kickoff event for the 18th annual Wallace Stegner Center Symposium. The lecture this year addresses the topic of the emerging alliance of religion and ecology. I'm Bob Keiter. I direct the Wallace Stegner Center for Land Resources and the Environment here at the S.J. Quinney College of Law. And I'd like to begin by thanking our donors who have made both this lecture and our annual symposium possible. In particular, the R. Harold Burton Foundation is our founding donor for the symposium, and the Burton Foundation has provided principal funding for us since 1996. I'd also like to acknowledge as a principal donor the Cultural Vision Fund, which provides support for a variety of Stegner Center programs, including the symposium, our Young Scholar program, and our lecture series. And we are also indebted to our sponsors, who have also provided funding, the Nature Conservancy in Utah, the Utah Interfaith Power and Light, and the American Bar Association section of Environment, Energy, and Resources. Let me, at this early juncture, encourage those of you who aren't registered to join us for the symposium on Friday and Saturday. Registration is still open. Brochures are available on the table outside or online at the Stegner Center website. You can sign up today or tomorrow morning. Before I introduce our esteemed Wallace Stegner lecturer, I have the distinct privilege and honor of making an important and, I should note, the initial public announcement of an extraordinary grant that the College of Law has just received to support additional sustainability features in the new law building on which we plan to break ground on June 4th. Building upon a lengthy and productive relationship with the Stegner Center and in recognition of the College of Law's and the Stegner Center's enduring commitment to environmental sustainability, the Alternative Visions Fund of the Chicago Community Trust has awarded the College of Law a grant of $4 million to help us to build the most sustainable new law building possible, with the goal of seeking LEED Platinum status, which would make it the first LEED Platinum law school building in the world. Among other things, this extraordinary grant will enable us to pioneer gray water capture and reuse in the new building, utilize on and off-site photovoltaic systems, install electric car charging stations, safeguard the building windows to avoid deadly bird collisions, and employ LED lighting throughout the building. And there's more. In total, the sustainability features in the new building, which in addition to their environmental benefits, will save the College of Law a considerable amount in operating expenses over the coming year, will cost something in the neighborhood of $9 million. To help us cover the remaining cost, the Alternative Visions Fund has also offered another $500,000 as a matching grant for funds that we raise in our Green Building Fund. It's a major challenge that the Alternative Visions Fund has put before us, but one that we cannot refuse and that we cannot fail to meet. And we hope that many of you who are here today will choose to participate in that campaign by visiting the Green Building Fund on the Stegner Center's website. Several people have been instrumental in bringing this grant about. Bob Adler, the College of Law's incoming interim dean, Jan Nystrom, the Stegner Center's associate director, my Stegner Center faculty and staff colleagues who are responsible for our many programs and activities, and our architects at the VCBO Smith Group. We hope you're as excited as we are about this tremendous opportunity and that this incredible grant and matching challenge presents for us. Now, as the College of Law continues to move forward with our Building Justice campaign, we will also be building a new model for a more sustainable future at the College of Law. You'll be hearing more about the Alternative Vision Fund grant in the days ahead, but for the moment, please join me to express our profound appreciation to the Alternative Vision Fund for its generosity and its far-sighted commitment to a more environmentally sustainable world. Now, to the matter at hand, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Mary Evelyn Tucker, who is a senior lecturer and senior research scholar at Yale University, where she holds appointments in the School of Forestry and Environmental Studies, as well as the Divinity School. She co-founded and co-directs with John Grimm the Forum on Religion and Ecology, through which they organized a series of 10 conferences on world religions and ecology at the Center for Study of World Religions at Harvard Divinity School. They then served as series editors for the 10 volumes that emerged from that conference and that were distributed by Harvard University Press. She's also a research associate at the Reischauer Institute of Japanese Studies at Harvard. In 2011, Mary Evelyn completed The Journey of the Universe with, that's a name here, I assume part of it was Journey of the Universe, with Brian Swim, which includes a book from Yale University Press, a film on PBS, and an educational series of interviews. She's also the author of a number of books: Worldly Wonder, Religions Enter Their Ecological Phase, Moral and Spiritual Cultivation in Japanese Neo-Confucianism, and The Philosophy of Ki. She's also edited a number, or co-edited a number of volumes, including Worldviews and Ecology, Buddhism and Ecology, Confucianism and Ecology, Hinduism and Ecology, and When Worlds Converge. She has edited several of Thomas Berry's books, including Evening Thoughts, The Sacred Universe, and The Christian Future and the Fate of the Earth. She's a member of the Interfaith Partnership for the Environment at the United Nations Environment Program. She served on the International Earth Charter Drafting Committee from 1997 to 2000 and is a member of the Earth Charter International Council. She holds degrees from Trinity College, SUNY Fredonia, Fordham University, and a PhD from Columbia University. We're very pleased to welcome Dr. Mary Evelyn Tucker as this year's Wallace Stegner.
Thank you so much, Bob. And I'm reminded that the names of two of your books are actually what we're about today in this weekend, one being Keeping Faith with Nature and the other Reclaiming the Native Home of Hope. Beautiful titles. And I think that's the spirit of this whole conference. And I want to, of course, draw into our midst Wallace Stegner, one of the great American writers, heroes for the environment. A national treasure, really. I've studied Japan for many years, and they name their great writers and artists national treasures, and I think he is certainly among our best. I understand, too, as I was thinking about this, I believe his death date is April 13th, so we're just about at that anniversary of his passing. And I just wanted to quote one short line of his that also brings to mind what is at stake here. What are we about? What do we have to draw on? And he was always talking about drawing on the hidden strengths, even though we may live lives of quiet desperation, as he would quote often. But he called us to respect for heroic virtues, fortitude, resolution, and magnanimity. And that, I think, is the call of this conference, the call certainly of this talk, the call of this emerging alliance of religion and ecology. So, I want to just highlight the fact that what we're talking about here is both a field within academia and a force in the larger society, interfaith power and light, grassroots environmentalism, and so on. This is based on the notion that our cultural attitudes and behaviors are derived largely from worldviews and values, and those come from, of course, the world's religions, but from a variety of other sources, including humanitarian and secular values, environmental ethics, what's called biophilia, love of nature, E.O. Wilson's term, aesthetics, and the arts. So there's a broad field that we can draw on here. I'm going to be speaking about religion, but many people say at the end of it, where's spirituality? Where's the arts? And I'm signaling from the beginning, it's right there. But it's also part of a growing field of environmental humanities within academia. And I think it's a very exciting move because most environmental studies programs have had a strong emphasis on science, on policy, economics more recently, laws you have here, an amazing array of courses as I was looking at them this morning. But environmental history is about 40 years old, as is environmental philosophy, which has done a lot with environmental ethics. Environmental literature, you've got Terry Tempest Williams here in your midst, and I was just with her over the weekend showing the film, The Journey of the Universe. These nature writers who've drawn us into a profound sense of the connection we have with the natural world and the beauty of this landscape right here in Utah, for example. The environmental arts, and finally, religion and ecology. I say finally because this is a newer field. It's emerged about 20 years ago, 15 plus years ago, as we started those Harvard conferences in 1996. Now, where did I get my inspiration, really, to begin to do this work? I went to Japan in 73, 74, 40 years ago, literally, at this time, I set off for a great journey because I had gone to a college in DC where Nancy Pelosi went and so on that didn't have anything on Asian studies. So I was very disoriented when I got there. But it had a profound influence on me in terms of understanding how nature impacts us. This is a picture, of course, in the front of a Shinto temple where the whole natural world is alive with kami, with spirits. This is one of the great entries in Hiroshima to a Shinto temple on the inland sea. So it's marked, this is the sacred space coming up to the temple, and or to the shrine in this case. Now we're moving towards Buddhism, and Zen Buddhism was a major influence on me in those years, as it's been for a number of people in the West. But these gardens, the Zen gardens in Kyoto, I would go there almost every weekend, and it was before Japan was even a tourist destination. There were very few foreigners. And I was deeply inspired by this simplicity, just as you have here in the desert. It awakens us. Just stone and rock and a few plants. It awakens us to something more than ourselves, doesn't it? It's why the desert is so inspiring for all world religions. But there were other forces in Japan that were of interest to me a bit later. And here we have one of the great castles, the daimyo, and you've seen these in samurai movies and so on. But this is Confucian-based, a political force, an educational force, a religious force. This is a Confucian temple. And I became keenly interested in how the Japanese and, of course, the Chinese and Koreans and people in Hong Kong and Singapore and Taiwan as well were influenced by this tradition. Probably no other tradition has influenced more people than this tradition, just by its longevity and the size. But what began to disturb me over the last 35, almost 40 years, yes, since going to Japan. Here is the Japan, the Fuji, that I knew 40 years ago. Here it is, you see, over these last number of decades. And this happened literally in 40 years, so quickly, all through Asia. So we have the beautiful rice fields, the paddy fields, which are iconic. And when they're flooded in the springtime, just about now, you can see the reflection of the moon in it. You can see the reflection of the stars. These are beautiful, beautiful creations. And here we have, as we now know, you know, a Fukushima, we have a whole range of issues that have come up, even what is farming and what is the nature of agricultural farming, industrial farming. I mean, here's Guilin in the south of China. Here's what's happened in so many of the Chinese rivers, and you just read probably of the pigs in a river recently. China in particular, and India especially, these two great nations, these two extraordinary civilizations, were of such concern for those of us who were students of Asia, what was going to happen as they modernized. And that was the inspiration for these conferences at Harvard. And Vasudha Narayan, I'm so delighted, is here, our colleague from India and from University of Florida, was part of those conferences. As well in China, this was the China I went to in the early 80s, and of course, as you well know, what's happened in the cities in the north and in Shanghai as well, tremendous pollution. My niece who was working there had to come back. Everyone who goes there gets bronchial diseases and so on. So now we're in another world. We're back here on the North American continent, and my husband, John Grimm, my partner in life and in work, is a student of Native American traditions and indigenous traditions. And we've been adopted into this Crow family and have gone many summers to Montana, especially for the Sundance ritual. And the incredible blessing of being in that community, and despite their deprivation, despite the loss of jobs and the alcohol and drinking and things that pervade these reservations, as you well know, they have kept alive rituals that are for their communities, for healing of their children, but for healing of the whole Earth community. And it's extremely impressive how they do this. Of course, there's many issues of indigenous rights, what's happening to their lands all over the world because of extractive industries and so on. This is the tar sands up in Canada where Native peoples have been protesting for some time now. The United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples calls for the preservation of their culture, their tradition, their lands. You know this, again, from the West. These are very big issues right here in our communities. And we have seen this in many parts of the world. Sorry. Now, Thomas Berry is an inspiration for several people here in this audience, and he certainly has been for us. I met him just after coming back from Japan in 1974 and worked with him until his death in 2009. These are some of the books that have influenced this emerging alliance of religion and ecology, and also this Journey of the Universe film and book. Dream of the Earth was when he first said, we need a large story of who we are as humans. But one of his most famous sayings is this notion that the universe itself is a primary community. In other words, we've come out of a 14 billion year evolutionary process. Our Earth is a sacred Earth community that has given us life over 4.6 billion years. This changes everything. It changes the sense of who we are as humans. And he would suggest the universe is a communion of subjects, not a collection of objects. And this is the major shift in our midst at this very historic moment in human history. How do we recover, reclaim, reorient this sense of our nativeness, our embeddedness, our kinship with this sacred universe? He has said no previous human community has faced such a comprehensive crisis that threatens ecosystems and species on a global scale. We have to see the size and scale and complexity of this crisis, and I have seen it in so many parts of the world. And he would say we have ethics for homicide and suicide and after World War II genocide, but not yet for biocide or ecocide. Although there's a woman, Polly Higgins, in Europe, in the UK, who's working on ecocide. This notion of what will happen to the ecosystems, what will happen to future generations if we don't reverse course, if we don't bring in a moral and spiritual perspective. Now, all of this has come from reasons we're well acquainted with population growth. We went from 2 billion to 6 billion in one century, and everything has changed, everything. And connected to population, of course, is increased consumption. We set the standard, I think, in certain ways. Affluenza is kind of a disease, you might say. The consumerist society, we were told to go shopping after 9/11. But this has spread around the world, this American dream. So China and India are moving into this rapidly as well. Urbanization, we've gone over 50% as a species now that live in cities. This means, obviously, alienation from the land, by and large, and that's going to increase. We have this climate change issue, which is massive and almost intractable. We can talk a lot about this, but I want to put into the equation that the other macro-scale problem is that of biodiversity loss. It's almost invisible, though, that these creatures are all on the endangered species list. How many of you are aware that we are in a sixth extinction period? Okay, so when we went to the Hall of Biodiversity, when we went to the American Museum of Natural History in 1998 to say we'd like to do a conference here on religion and the environment, it was kind of scary. It was scary to do that at these things at Harvard even, but it's very scary to go into the science-based museum and say, can we have this discussion? And the provost there said, absolutely, because we have just had a search for an ornithologist. And of the six finalists, four had had their birds go extinct while they were studying them. And that was such a wake-up call to the museum. There's a book called Watching from the Edge of Extinction. It's a huge issue now in science. How are we going to cope? How are we going to live with grieving and loss? And how can our religious communities bring us into a deeper understanding of this? So we have worked from the beginning, as we did at this conference at the Natural History Museum, with science, with policy. They have been our dialogue partners, because we're saying religions have been late. They're necessary, but not sufficient. And so some of the partners have been the scientists, E.O. Wilson, our wonderful dean at Peter Crane, the former head of NOAA, Jane Lubchenco, Ursula Goodenough, and Tom Lovejoy, who was one of the inventors, along with E.O. Wilson, of biodiversity, the idea of it. Also with policy, Gus Speth, economics and law, and that's why I'm so delighted to be part of this conference at a law school. My father was a lawyer. What does it mean to begin to think about earth jurisprudence or the rights of nature? One of the biggest movements has been the Universal Declaration of the Rights of Mother Earth. 33,000 indigenous people gathered in Cochabamba in Bolivia to bring this, to write this document, which I urge you to look at, but they also have brought it to the UN. There's so much happening in law, and these conjunctions are very, very exciting. We've worked with many of these organizations, ranging from science at the top to the National Religious Partnership. And of course, Interfaith Power and Light has been a strong partner as well. So between science and religion and policy and law and economics and so on, what is our common ground for this huge interdisciplinary meeting of the largest problem humans have ever had to face? Namely, the environmental crisis and all of its intended aspects. I think we need to come back to the fact that our common ground is a sense that we as humans have wonder before the natural world. This is obviously a child, but we all have this, and how we reignite that sense will be a way into the future. Wonder from the cell all the way up through the life-giving systems of our planet, the trees that are just beginning to bloom here in Salt Lake. I took a walk this morning. How glorious. The plane trees right here on your campus just coming into bloom, the beginnings of plums and cherries and blossoms and so on. We live in a magical world, don't we? So you can see I'm in love with trees in particular, but the fish, the birds, the species where we live and dwell in an earth community, Our closest cousins, the primates, especially in Africa, are they going to go extinct? Will they go extinct in our children's lifetime? What will happen to the elephants right now in Africa? These are real and pressing issues for all of us. This iconic image from space, the Earth from space in the 1960s, I think is still a source of immense inspiration and hope. That we know we live on a blue-green water planet, unique in the solar system, as far as we know. And this is what we are working on behalf of, an Earth community for future generations. The reason we've done this Journey of the Universe story is also to ignite that sense of the long journey. I feel I'm in Mormon land here, where lineage and legacy of family is so important. And you've helped people around the world with your sources of ancestry here and so on. But what we're coming to, aren't we, is a sense that it's not just the human lineage, which is marvelous and a source of great hope and connection, but it's also the lineage of the land, the lineage of the globe itself, the lineage of our solar system. The fact that carbon-based life could not have existed on this planet without supernovas, where all the elements exploded and actually are our ancestors. That's why we say the stars are our ancestors. What an incredible heritage, you see, for our children to realize what they live amidst. As we've already discussed earlier, it's a book, it's a series of interviews where we had 10 scientists telling the story in even greater depth, 10 environmentalists saying, therefore, how shall we live? How shall we have food that's nourishing? What about a new economics? What about education? And so on. The Earth Charter I just want to put into the mix as well, because if we have a large-scale story of who we are as humans, this journey of the universe, we also have the first global ethics, this Earth Charter that came out of the Earth Summit in 1992, the UN Conference on Environment and Development, trying to figure out these two nodes to the future. But Gorbachev and Maurice Strong said at that conference, we need a new Ten Commandments. We need an ethical framework for sustainability for the future. And over 10 years, this document emerged. I was very privileged to be part of the drafting. And I just want to maybe read the lines under Earth, Our Home, that humanity is part of a vast, evolving universe. Earth, our home, is alive with a unique community of life. That's where we're going, and that's also where we're going with the religious communities, because they are moving slowly, we might say, sometimes without a surety, understandably, with bumps, with mistakes, and so on, but they are moving into what I would suggest is a new ecological phase. There are leaders with statements ranging from this new Pope Francis, I'll speak about in a moment, to grassroots eco-justice. And again, there's people in your midst who have saved incredible amounts of land from a perspective of grassroots environmentalism or eco-justice, combining land and people. The academics, what we're trying to do at Yale and elsewhere with engaged scholarship, and I mention our student Jason Brown, who's here and is going on to UBC to continue this kind of work. He was at Yale earlier. So here we have some of the leaders. And while leaders are important, so are the laity, but I just want to highlight a few. You know, this new Pope Francis, who would have thought he would have taken the name Francis of Assisi, right? And that he actually is a person who cares deeply about the poor. I don't know if you've heard how much he's done, but even when they were going to put a mink over, some kind of fur over his shoulders, and he rejected it, and he said, the carnival is over. Amazing, amazing, yeah. He didn't live in the bishop's house in South America. You know, he lived in an apartment and so on and so forth. Anyway, I think we're going to see some changes. But most importantly, at his installation, he had representatives from the different world religions, which was the first time ever. And he mentioned 9 times protection of creation. So there may be hope from unexpected places, shall we say. The Dalai Lama, of course, and many Buddhist leaders have been speaking about the environment for a long time. Unexpectedly, perhaps, have you heard of Bartholomew, the Greek Orthodox patriarch? Okay, so he's the leader of the Greek Orthodox Church, and I'll mention more later, but he has been outspoken. In 1997, in Los Angeles, Santa Barbara Church, he says, these are crimes against creation. This is ecological sin. Powerful, powerful leader. And of course, Rowan Williams, the past head of the Anglican Church, also has spoken out on these issues. A few more, Thich Nhat Hanh, you may well know, down on the bottom, the Dharma Master Cheng Yen, leading a Buddhist group, a nun in Taiwan. Catherine Jeffers Shorey, head here of the Episcopal Church in the U.S., and Joel Hunter, the Evangelical Church. We'll have an opportunity tomorrow to hear from many leaders, both academic and in their own churches, synagogues, and so on. The environmental justice movement is also growing. The poor are the ones who often suffer from, as Cancer Alley would tell us down in Los Angeles, where the petrochemical industry is right next to the African American community. Many native tribes have suffered from uranium mining, also in the Southwest. Wangari Maathai, there in the middle, was a Nobel Prize winner, a wonderful friend to us and to this work, and someone who empowered women to plant trees, very inspired by her native tradition and also her Christian training here in the U.S. We have a whole book series on ecology and justice, bringing this together, which I recommend to you. Thomas Berry is in there, Brian Swim is in there, and so on. But this is a new conjunction within the religion and ecology movement. One example, just from overseas, is the Suji Buddhist community. You cannot believe the scale on which they are recycling things, these 60,000 centers. But then they're taking the plastic and weaving them into blankets and bringing them to refugees or to, like they brought them to Katrina and so on. So it's a whole recycling to help people in various parts of the world. Now that I have your attention, we'll come back to the problems of religion. Just wanted to put it in the mix in case you hadn't thought about it. Or, we're not trying to be naive here at all. We understand that there are plenty of problems with religion, and we're going to just outline a few problems and promise, and know that these work together, sometimes in great tension. So we have intolerance, we have dogmatism, we have exclusive claims to truth. The picture on the top, is a conflict in India of Hindu and Muslim groups over the founding of Rama's birthplace and taking down a mosque. So we know that this is around the world. There are also tendencies in many of the traditions, I would say mostly the Western traditions, though, the Abrahamic traditions, otherworldly orientations or personal salvation, the rapture, I'm going to be fine, doesn't matter, leave behind the rest. We also have nature being devalued. This is Boniface cutting down the sacred groves. And we have what is one of the most both problematic and promising aspects of many of the world's religion, the anthropocentric focus. But notice, this is Leonardo da Vinci. This is a human against the cosmos, with the cosmos. So if we move from a human-centered focus to nature, to the earth, and to the cosmos, we might be able to shift this focus only on the human. Now, for the promise of religion, aren't you relieved? We can move away from those problems for a bit. But why are we saying that religions can really make a contribution to these environmental issues? Huge numbers of people. There's 1 billion Muslims. There's 1.2 billion Catholics. There's 1 billion Hindus plus. There are 1 billion Confucians plus. You know, amazing numbers of people. And with institutional authority, if this Pope made one encyclical letter to the faithful on the environment, think how many people would be influenced, you see? The power of text and tradition. Clearly, we're moving from how do we take these great scriptures And again, tomorrow we'll hear more about it. What will this mean for Mormonism as it looks at its texts and traditions, at the roles that humans can have with nature into the future? Education and moral persuasion, tremendous resource there in the world's religions. Environmental ethics in action, the picture up on the left is solar panels on the Yale Divinity School, and so on the bottom are the evangelicals at Messiah College, care for creation being central to the evangelical movement for many, many people now. So, taking a breath, what we're trying to do, and this would be a whole lecture in itself, but we're trying to also expand the notion of religion from just a Western notion, okay? Why are we trying to do this? For a range of reasons, because we're trying to say religion has functioned very differently in many parts of the world. But I'm also, I haven't really said this in public so overtly, but you know, we have a movement of new atheism, right? We have Dawkins and Dennett and Hutchins. How many of you have heard these names? Okay, so the new atheist movement is rather strong, rather vocal, and you know what they're doing? They're taking a caricature of certain aspects of Christianity that maybe in their childhood were not so great. And they are saying, this is religion, right? And what we would like to do as historians of religion is shift that conversation. That's not religion and science. That's a caricature of religion. So as we begin to expand our understanding of how religions have functioned for people around the world for millennia, we can say there's also a larger understanding that all religions have situated the human community within the cosmos and with nature. This is part of what religions do. So as it says here, that it's related people to their bioregions, to seasonal cycles, to agricultural rhythms, meteorological patterns, and celestial movements, and so on. And a new book that might be in here, anyway, coming up on ecology and religion, we're trying to do this by saying that if we see religion and ecology as a large part of, not exclusive, but as a stream of religions, we can say here's how it functions in this stream. The cosmology orients the human to the cosmos, to the stars, to the solar system. The communities ground humans within the human community and the natural community. Ritual nurtures us, food and water being central to so many religious communities and their ritual practices. Ethics transforms the human. And finally, personally, through religious practice, we are awakened, hopefully, and bring that awakening back to the world to make a difference. So we're saying that religious cosmologies then embed humans in the universe, and religious ecologies embed them in nature. Now, these are maybe new ideas. Maybe we can discuss them in the Q&A. But this is part of what we were trying to do in the Harvard Conference Series for 3 years, which I say was a big challenge at Harvard for lots of reasons. But this notion of retrieval, reevaluation, and reconstruction is in part what religions have done throughout their history. It's why theologians look at texts and tradition and try and adjudicate changes, whether it's attitudes towards women. And I understand the Mormon conference this Sunday had women praying within the conference for the first time. And these are changes, right, that are happening because of retrieval, reevaluation, and reconstruction. Here's an example of that from Genesis. So what is the meaning of dominion? This passage 126. Well, a reevaluation would say, many Christian communities are saying stewardship or care for creation. As I say, some people prefer one language, others another. But the reconstruction then is, all right, if we're saying dominion is not just holding nature for use only for us, what does it mean then to say we have a responsibility for a broadened ethics among humans and non-humans? Now, this is not in a package. I'm not saying this is simple, but what I am saying is religious communities all across this country are reevaluating, you see, and rethinking this issue. What does it mean to be a Christian, a Jew? What does it mean to have stewardship for creation? So we had these culminating conferences in 98. As I say, the provost let us come into the IMAX theater rent-free because he was so concerned about biodiversity loss and so on. Bill Moyers interviewed Vasudha Narayan and many other representatives from the different world religions. Great generosity of people like Bill and the museum and Du Wei Ming, one of the great Confucian scholars. We then started this forum on religion and ecology, which is at Yale. And there's a large website you can take a look at of bibliographies and texts and statements and also syllabi. How do you teach this? We have a newsletter once a month. And if you want to have your email on it, we're happy to have you join that. About 12,000 people are on it now. We have this book series, and these are edited, these are scholarly volumes in some ways, but they were trying to say text, tradition, practice. What are the engaged practices on the ground that communities are working on? So these were a beginning, took 7 years to put them out, but much more has happened since then. There's a journal, Worldviews. This new book that we're working on, Ecology and Religion, and trying to bring in more of the ecology, the history of ecology. There's a whole wonderful film called Renewal, 8 case studies of grassroots religious environmentalism across the US. This book on the Daedalus volume was the first book, the first conference and publication on religion and climate change. Hopefully there'll be a sheet of some of the URLs as you leave, and you can pick them up later. Interfaith Power and Light has been mentioned, and we have people working on that right here, Sally Bingham being the founder. We did a conference on religion and animals. How does this matter for how we treat animals? Is factory farming of animals a good thing or problematic? And I'm moving towards conclusion here, but there has been for almost 30 years an Earth Mass at the Episcopal Cathedral in New York, celebrating the Feast of St. Francis, where animals come into the cathedral. Have you heard of this celebration? It's spread to churches around the country now. You can bring your pets, have them blessed, and so on. Paul Winter, the great musician, brings in sounds of the whales and dolphins and so on. It's quite an amazing event. Religion and water. I noticed one of your faculty members is a specialist in water issues. Here is Bartholomew, the patriarch that I mentioned, and he has done, over the last 15 years, 8 extraordinary symposiums on water, bringing scientists, policy people, lawyers, especially from the EU, and we've been on a number of these very moving conferences. Here's one in the Amazon that we went on, where the native people and the head of the Orthodox Church, the Orthodox patriarch asked forgiveness for conversion of native people and for some of the exploitation of them, their traditions, and so on. It was incredibly moving. So reconciliation, you see, between traditions is also possible as we move toward a larger common good. So to conclude, these are some of the virtues, shall we say, and the values that we feel from this research and this work are common to all the world's religions that we can bring forward for the future of the planet and next generations. One is a deep sense of reverence for the Earth community, which includes humans, animals, ecosystems, trees, the biota, respect for myriad species. Why is biodiversity disappearing? How do we consider other species, you see? Are they ethically valuable to us? The restraint in use of natural resources. Do we really need to keep all the lights on all the time? Do we really need to walk into every hotel and have the air conditioning or heater on? You know, let's think about these issues, and maybe the religions can make a difference. Redistribution of technology and aids. Many of the communities have been, World Vision and others, around the world helping with technology and aid. And I think this will be a very important contribution. Reciprocity with all life. This is where a renewing sense of reciprocity, not just with humans, which we have a long way to go, for sure, but reciprocity with nature that also feeds us, that nurtures us. This is the source of our life, our food, our water, our air, our soil. And it brings us to this responsibility for the future of life, doesn't it? If we are the first generation to realize this picture of the Earth from the Moon, if we're the first generation to realize our great story of the epic of evolution leaves us in a calendar picture on the 30th day of the month, in the very, very last hour of this month, 150,000 years we have been Homo sapiens sapiens on this planet, a very short time for a 14 billion year evolutionary story. And if we say 150,000 years of being Homo sapiens sapiens, are we learning to own, up to, or inherit our last name of wisdom? What does that mean to really become sapient species, sentient and sapient species? And I think, to conclude, it may mean that restoration of ecosystems is one of our greatest tasks, a great work, as Thomas Berry might have said, and also restoration of the human spirit. Because if we are in this period of looking for alternative energies, if we are in this period of oil depletion, gas eventual depletion, we are in the greatest shift of energy to support civilization itself. And that is what is at stake. What is the nature of civilization? What is the nature of culture that has been deeply influenced by these great world religions? And I would suggest that one of the missing links is the energy of the human spirit, which comes not exclusively, but in great waves, in great streams from the world's religions. And that renewing source of energy, I think, is something we can draw on for all future generations. Thank you very much.
Essential if we're going to have the needed religious spiritual influence on ecology is how can we ramp it up in terms of quickening, because the data suggests that we have very few years before we're fried.
Well, I think we're all aware, aren't we, that there's an urgency about these issues, and I welcome the question because that's what Thomas Berry was saying 30 years ago. You know, this is a very urgent problem. The size and scale of it, we're still just taking in. The rapidity of climate change, what's happening with the melting glaciers that we saw in Greenland on the Patriarch's trip and so on, is deeply worrying. And I can assure you, like many of you who are parents perhaps, that I am awake late at night thinking about this, and it's my life work, you know, and I think many people's life work who are here at the Stegner Center as well. But I think that this is why we need to draw on, perhaps, a spiritual, religious, and ethical perspective for some kind of hope that's realistic, that grounds us. Because if we say urgency is that we're going to drown in these problems, or that they're intractable, unsoluble, we will be self-fulfilling, won't we? But if we say we do have these incredible resources, these incredible centers, I mean, think of a green law building here in Utah, the first in the country. This is a sign of great hope. And I'm taking that back to Yale and challenging them. You know, but I think we can draw on, and this, if you look at the Earth Charter too, at the beginning, this is what we were struggling with. What is the challenge of urgency and the challenge of hope and possibility? And if we can fuse these, we can create an energy that's grounded and that can move us forward. So, big question, small answer, but yes.
Thank you for a great talk, thoroughly enjoyed it. I have one comment, which is that perhaps you let religions, who are a bit soft, easy on religions. Surely you pointed out some of their problems and then went into their promises. But I would like to really focus on one big problem that affects all these things that we talk about. Now, ecofeminism. Ecofeminism is a big movement that shows that there is a correlation, a parallel between subjugation and exploitation of women and subjugation and exploitation of nature. That's how they're connecting our struggle to maintain our stuff with nature along with our ethical responsibilities toward other human beings. Now, their point, and I agree with that, is that it's patriarchy, common to most religions, that has been doing damage on these both fronts, that we find in this macho orientation, violence, penchant for hunting and all that, you know, but that also has got correlation with humans and nature. And so, would you like to address that aspect of patriarchy vis-a-vis religion, because that's a central aspect. Without that, I don't think that we can really go very far. Thank you.
Amen. No, but you couldn't be more correct. And I, as a woman, you know, feel this in academia, and in many ways, we could talk about this for a long, long time. But I think it's a hugely important point. And in fact, I'll go back to John and say we have to have another slide that puts this in, because it's very, very true. And I think, you know, just on a very practical level, the empowerment of women in terms of educating women both for jobs and for reproductive health has actually helped reduce population, and the UN Population Fund had no idea about that, you see? So, I mean, this is empowerment of women in a whole range of ways that we need to think about, right? I mean, we don't have children, but we feel our students are our children, and we are really working on behalf of them. And we also feel that my husband's a very nurturing person, you see, and he's been hugely supportive of me as a woman. These are different role models, you know. But I think we also have to say, don't we, that we as men and women, as young people and old, can nurture in a variety of ways. And it's the nurturing that we need to pull forth, not just from women, but from men. So anyway, thank you for the comment. New slide.
I want to go back to the question of urgency for a moment. I'm as much a believer as you are in the need to find hope within religious culture on these issues. But I'm wondering if we could go back to the problems for a moment. And I'd like to hear you sort of talk your way through what you would say to somebody who says, look, my hope, when you start to describe a problem that's that complex and that is that difficult for me to measure my impact or my ability to improve the problem, then my hope, my religious hope, sort of slips into a kind of passivity. I say to myself, it's out of my hands, it's in God's hands, surely nothing that's happening is a surprise to him or her or whatever one's idea of God is. But to say that my faith in providence, or my trust in providence, tells me there's only so much I can do. I guess what I'm wondering is, how do you keep religious hope connected to principled actions, even when we can't measure adequately what our individual impact might be for the better or for the worse, but still keep that urgency alive? I mean, it does seem to me that there is a point at which, for people of faith, myself included, I have to sort of partition a little bit and say to myself, existentially I'm looking at this situation and it looks really bad and I need to act urgently. My hope tells me that there's providential purpose, but that doesn't mean that I'm obligated to interpret events as God's will. In fact, that's quite dangerous theology in my mind, so I stay focused on a more existentialist approach to a problem. But I find that a lot of other people of faith don't see it quite that same way, and they easily slip into a hope that is really actually a kind of passivity or acceptance of what's happening. And, as you know, it also leads to a refusal to look empirically at the evidence, right? I mean, the evidence itself starts to become a threat to one's sense of trust in providence.
Right. So thank you for that question, which has many parts. But I think, again, this is at the heart of the matter. It absolutely is. You know, I think this is why in the middle section of this talk we have, let's re-examine what is religion, okay? Which would be a whole long, you know, discussion, answer to your question. But I think, and that's why we're saying it's not just otherworldly. It's not just, I mean, reliance on providence is a huge gift. It's a, you know, gift of faith and so on. But if it means passivity, it's not maybe a true virtue, you see, for our times. And so discernment, I think, is what's at stake here. Discernment of what it means to be a person of faith. And that's why, you see, we have Journey of the Universe in the mix. Do we have faith in the long-term evolutionary processes that, against great odds, actually brought forth life? If you want to derive faith, just think about how long it took, a billion years, for the first cell to emerge, and how long life itself had to take to emerge amidst great chaos, you see, amidst death, and so on. And I think the heart of the matter is coming back. If we say religious traditions have helped humans deal with death and life, those are some of the key issues, right? It's a similar moment now. Are we going to allow the planet to die, you see? And so if we can connect up both the large-scale sense that life has emerged against great obstacles and against great odds, and yet is extremely precious, extremely complex, and that humans can have some kind of faith in providence or in this process, but without, and here's the other part of it, it's not just action, is it? Because our actions have had many unintended consequences. It's action that is aligned to the complexity of these ecosystems, the complexity of life itself. I'll give you a couple examples of unintended consequences. Even the so-called efficient light bulbs have mercury in them originally, right? Solar panels, which we have on our house, have rare earth metals, which are very difficult to get and getting more and more rare. They're in our cell phones too. To help the ethanol notion, right, created a food crisis around the world, thinking we're going to put it into our cars. So action alone, you see, it's intelligent action, thoughtful action, action that actually has a sense of longer-term purpose, which is what religions can help us towards, you see? So long, long answer to an important question, but I think faith in providence is crucial, but faith in aligned, intelligent, and engaged action with humility is where we need to go, not hubris. And geoengineering is not a solution to our climate change, for example. So. Yes?
I just wondered if you have been experiencing in your journey. We met years ago at an Orion conference with Fire and Grit. But my experience has been more that I simply opened up my heart to what's happening is that it stops being so much in fear as it is really beginning to experience myself as a member of the cosmos, and that the cosmos has life, has energy, and then it is, you just said humility, and I'm wondering if you found others on their journey, because from that I got involved in planning, done lots of things and finding out ways now to regroup. But to me, it's like Thomas Berry, when I got this dream of the earth, he said it was a communion of subjects. I said, oh my God, here is someone who really understands. And I just wonder how much we can help bring about that experience, because it seems like to me that it's that experience is going to be needed.
So thank you. You know, what we need to spell out here is to your question. Namely, when I'm saying cosmology, okay, that religions have had this sense of connecting us to a larger cosmos. It's a big word, but it means this. It means a connection with gratitude to the fact that the sun is the source of all plant life, right, and therefore of all our life. So you see, our sense of gratitude, our sense of virtue can extend outward, right, to that which nourishes life and so on. So here's the two parts of a wonderful question would be, religions have had that in their past. They have that sense of microcosm of the human, macrocosm of the cosmos. See, it's very rich in Hinduism, the Mahapurusha, the great person. It's very rich in Confucianism, that we are the mind and heart of heaven and earth. Okay, the Taoists have it. And we have it as a cosmic Christ of the universe in St. Paul, you see, in the Christian tradition. It's richly there that we are part of something magnificent and larger than us. Now, the challenge is, both through education and experience and writing and visuals, which is why we made this film, how do we actually experience that? So it's not just in our head. So on Tuesday, while I'm at Boulder showing our film and doing some talks, John was having our class with Journey of the Universe with Yale students, largely graduate students, and I was amazed because a graduate student did exactly this. He said, they all have to do kind of reports, and it was on Journey of the Universe. He said, let's imagine what our relation is to a supernova. And these kids got into it just tremendously. You know, I was amazed, because this is kind of heady graduate school. So I think, and I'm not talking woo-woo stuff here, okay? And I'm not just talking pantheism here either. Really, we need to get more sophisticated about these terms and these ideas. I am talking about the connection to life, the connection to the cells in our body. This is sacred. These are sacred processes. Of course, you can take from your traditions a creator at the beginning and so on. But would this creator want this to go extinct? That's the question we have to ask our religious traditions. Anyway, lots more to say. Yes, I think, yeah, this lady and then this lady.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Tucker. But first of all, I'm the token Buddhist for the panel tomorrow. And I have some curiosities about Buddhism itself. I guess I wanted to ask you how everybody else, in your opinion, perceives Buddhism, much less indeed Buddhism, and the role that Buddhists play in the ecology and the crisis that we're facing now. Your criticisms particularly, I think, are very important to us because we're just kind of clueless a lot of times about our own connection with other human species. It's the nature of the self-centered self to be self-centered.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm not... You know, and again, a couple questions there perhaps, but I welcome that in this sense. You know, we started the conferences at Harvard with Buddhism because it's a natural sensibility that a profound tradition which says we have to decenter the notion of self as substantive, as powerful, as ego, and we have to recenter it, you see, as part of the Buddha nature in all things. as a Zen tradition would say. Incredible notion that we're not the center of the universe. And that Buddhism, from its very origin, has this sense of pratityasamutpada, the together rising up of things, the immense interdependence of life. This is what ecology has been saying forever, you see? So the challenge is, as I think you're saying, is how do we bring this rich understanding in praxis of Buddhism, of interdependence, which is actually very freeing, and it's freeing for engaged action in the world, too. But how do we bring it into dialogue with ecology, you see? I mean, the whole chapter in this book on ecology and religion that we really struggled over is, so ecology from Haeckel on, from the 19th century thinkers on, had a notion of wholeness, okay? But they then other scientists like Tansley and so on said, we have to measure it. We have to have a biometrics of these cycles, nitrogen cycles and so on. So we have to measure it. So it became sort of mathematical, you know, and maybe even reductionistic a little bit. And so this, what Donald Worcester says, one of the great historians in his of the environment, in Nature's Economy, says this dialectic, this tension between holism and bioeconomics, you see, which is where we are now, is something we have to think about. And how can holism, that's not just simplistic, but really enter into ecological thinking, you see? Because it's my view, if you don't mind saying, you know, that ecosystem services, which dominates the discussion at our School of Forestry and Environmental Studies and in much of environmental thinking, and I am immensely grateful to Gretchen Daly and Bob Costanza and others who've thought through this. What does it mean? How many of you have heard the term even, ecosystem service? So, you know, it's valuing nature by the services to the human. Wetlands purify water and so on. It gives monetary value to nature. Important, but it's very instrumental for getting the financial community to pay attention to it. Would you say these mountains, this basin, this lake here, is this monetarily valuable? I don't think so. This is, I mean, it's historic geologically, right? There's an amazing geological formation here. It's historically and culturally valuable for Mormonism. These are not things you can put a financial value on, right? So, necessary but not sufficient, and how do we bring in fresh notions of holism and complexity? Okay, maybe one more. Should we do the... wonderful question. I don't know if George Handley's here today, but yes, okay, sorry. We've not met, but my husband has met you. Thank you, George. So we're relying on George and others in the community. And also, as I said, my former student at Yale, Jason Brown, and others to speak about this, of course, tomorrow. But, you know, I think it will have... I know George already has published on this and so on, but this will have a significant effect, I can assure you. I mean, we will put it up on our Yale website as the Forum on Religion and Ecology, as the LDS moves further into this. Now, you know, I'm an outsider. I'm here to learn, frankly. I hope to have a much longer conversation with George and others about this. But I'm good friends with Terry Tempest Williams and just showed the Journey of the Universe film with her up in Vermont this past weekend. And I think she, too, is longing for the church here to come forward on these issues. And what an influence you will have when you do, because the church is all over the world, the LDS, right? So this is part of the retrieval, reevaluation, and reconstruction that we look forward to with all the imperfections of these traditions, that there still is wisdom here to move forward. And I'll just end on this note that one of my great hopes for this conference, but for the future, is how all the traditions will move forward, but in particular, and today, how the Mormon Church will enter even more deeply into this discussion. Thank you so much for coming today.